Good evening and welcome to KBVR. I'm Kameron Young.
And I'm Stephanie Martinez. We have a special thank you going out to Bob Richardson tonight for helping to fix our teleprompters.
Thanks, Bob.
In a congressional hearing, Attorney General Janet Reno offered to resign. Reno's offer comes in light of her decision to end a 51-day standoff of cult members in the Branch Davidian compound in Waco, Texas. The standoff ended in a fire that killed more than 80 people, including 17 children. Reno told a House Judiciary Committee at the hearing that she won't engage in regretful thinking over her decision, but instead wants to learn from the deadly fire that ended the standoff. However, Michigan Congressman John Conyers has sharply criticized all the decisions that were made in the case. He has charged that the federal authorities botched the siege and could have prevented the fire. Conyers says the only thing that Reno has done right is her offering to resign.
In Washington, President Clinton has named former New York Police Commissioner Lee Brown to head up the country's battle against drugs. The 55-year-old Brown was Multnomah County Sheriff for more than a year, Atlanta Police Commissioner, and Houston Police Chief. He was the first black man to hold a rank higher than sergeant on the Houston force, where he is credited with easing racial tension and improving the department's image. Brown holds a doctorate in criminology. He helped establish the Portland State University Criminal Justice Program and taught school for 4 years. Last year, Brown resigned as New York's top cop. President Clinton says Lee Brown is the first police officer to head the war on drugs, and Clinton says he's making it a cabinet position. Most importantly, he chose Brown for the position because he gets results.
The announcement from the Pentagon scheduled for today regarding women serving in combat roles was made a day early. With full support from President Clinton, Defense Secretary Les Aspin announced his directive that will allow women to fly combat missions. The change in Pentagon policy will include that the armed forces provide justification for putting any battlefield role off limits to women. Betsy Freeman of the Air Force Association says the civilian group supports the decision and that women have made a very strong contribution to the military force since the early days of the Army Air Corps. Under Aspin's directive, women in the armed forces could be flying Navy and Air Force warplanes within months and Army combat helicopters within a year. Until now, the women have been allowed to serve only as flight instructors and as navigators. Cadets at the Air Force Academy in Colorado are hailing Aspin's order. One woman sophomore cadet says she's very excited about the order because it opens up a new area to work in. The Air Force has more than 16,000 pilots, about 300 of whom are women. In 1991, Congress approved legislation that lifted the ban on women to be assigned to combat aircraft. The pressure to lift the ban came in wake of the Persian Gulf War, when women in support roles were in the line of fire. A Bush presidential commission at that time voted against lifting the ban, leaving the issue for the Clinton administration to decide.
A senior member of the House Armed Services Committee who has led the Congress to lift the ban on women in combat roles is praising President Clinton and Defense Secretary Les Aspin. Colorado Democrat Patricia Schroeder says women clearly have the skills and strengths to perform in any situation. Aspin today ordered military service chiefs to drop restrictions on women flying combat missions and women serving aboard most Navy warships. The policy changes mean that within a year, dozens of women could be flying Navy and Air Force fighter jets and piloting the Army's most lethal attack choppers.
In Washington, at the Middle East peace talks, Syrian and Israeli negotiators have agreed to shelve, at least temporarily, the issue of Israel's withdrawal from the occupied territories. Israeli negotiators say they will take back 30 exiled Palestinians. The negotiators say the 30 were not involved in terrorism in the occupied lands. They are separated from almost 400 Palestinians stuck in camps in southern Lebanon. Talks between Israel and delegates from Syria, Jordan, Lebanon, and the Palestinians resume this week after a four-month hiatus.
President Clinton says he still believes the United States has to take tougher steps to stop the war in Bosnia. In a brief exchange with reporters at the White House, Clinton acknowledged Congress is divided over how to proceed in the Bosnian war. Clinton says he wants to strengthen the U.S. response and will try to persuade members of Congress and the allies to go along. Some lawmakers advocate bombing Serb artillery, while others say such action could drag the U.S. into another Vietnam. Meanwhile, Serbia's parliament is appealing to Serb leaders in neighboring Bosnia to look again at a new UN plan for peace in Bosnia. Serbia, as part of Yugoslavia, is under stiff new UN trade sanctions because of its backing for the Bosnian Serbs and the refusal to accept the peace plan. Because of the stalemate, the NATO allies have authorized their warships to chase ships carrying banned goods into Serbia. NATO ships in the Adriatic Sea are to pursue violators into the territorial waters of the new Yugoslavia, which is dominated by Serbia. Yugoslavia has incurred the sanctions because it backs Serbs fighting in Bosnia. A NATO official says the orders will also allow Allied ships to fire on sanctions-busting carriers with inert munitions, shells that don't explode on impact but do cause damage. Up to 8 NATO warships are in the Adriatic now. There are also a half dozen ships belonging to the Western European Union, a 9-nation defense organization.
An ethics organization calling themselves the Communitarian Network is proposing healthcare reforms that go beyond treatment. They address such things as unemployment, gun sales, car safety, and environmental hazards. The network wants to address the causes of health problems. Meanwhile, the network says the society has the right to impose extra health care on individuals whose habits, such as smoking or speeding, exhibit poor health behaviors and increase the public's health care costs. The network predicts that the Clinton administration can save money by implementing their plans.
In Michigan, authorities have cleared death doctor Jack Kevorkian of criminal wrongdoing for the February-assisted suicide of Hugh Gale. Kevorkian's critics have claimed that Gale changed his mind at the last minute, but prosecutors proved there was no hard evidence in support of the assertion. Kevorkian's win didn't get him too far, though. The California medical regulators have pulled his medical license, saying doctors do not assist people in committing suicide. Kevorkian has 30 days to appeal the decision.
The director of the Federal Bureau of Investigations and the director of the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms have also come into criticism for the roles they played in the standoff at Waco, Texas. ATF Director Stephen Higgins refused to admit that an agency member knew that the cult had been tipped off before the February 28th raid that began the standoff, saying only that the matter is being investigated. Meanwhile, the House Judiciary Committee Chairperson Jack Brooks of Texas called the FBI's response of doing what they thought they should have done as an excuse a little too late in coming.
It's truly a tragedy.
It's a tragedy. Hopefully, though, we'll have some good weather coming up next, and after that, we'll have stories on the nation's health. Looking forward to that.
It pours, pain is a force, happiness your source, keep going for yours. I know Dante put you in the inferno, but pain you'll learn though is not eternal. So now you're in the dungeon on the wall you hang.
In Chicago, a poll conducted for the American Medical Association surveyed over 1,500 people to discover that Americans are split on whether the nation's healthcare system should be private or public. 49% of those polled would rather pay more out of pocket for private healthcare, while 46% would prefer paying more in taxes and letting the government oversee the delivery of healthcare.
Scientists discuss new eye treatments at a seminar in University City, California that show promise for preventing blindness caused by herpes, AIDS, and diseases that kill the eye's light-sensing cells. The treatments include a vaccine to prevent repeated herpes eye infections and laser-zapped fat bubbles that deliver sight-saving drugs. These procedures could be widely available in the next 5 years, and implanted medicine pellets that slowly release sight-saving drugs in AIDS patients could be available as soon as in the next couple of years.
An advocacy group in Washington, D.C. reports that nearly two-thirds of disabled Americans who need help with basic activities, eating, taking a bath, or getting dressed, rely on friends or relatives. Families USA says givers are elderly, women in poor health who face stress and depression from the burden. The group is pushing for a national home care benefit package as part of President Clinton's health reform package.
Federal officials have opened temporary offices in Salem to handle requests for money to repair damage from last month's earthquake. Governor Roberts and officials from the Federal Emergency Management Agency and Small Business Administration held a news conference today to discuss available aid. The declaration from President Clinton paved the way for federal grants to repair public buildings and for low-interest loans to fix home and business damage. Federal emergency officials met today with state agencies and will meet on Monday with local government officials to determine how people should apply for the money. The federal government will pay 75% of the repair costs for the public facilities, with state and local governments paying the rest.
An Oregon Farm Workers Union is going to honor California farm labor leader Cesar Chavez during its traditional Cinco de Mayo celebration on Sunday. The memorial service is planned from 1 to 3 p.m. at the Woodburn headquarters of the Northwest Tree Planters and Farm Workers United. For the past 12 years, the union has celebrated International Workers' Day and Cinco de Mayo on the first Sunday in May. But union president Ramon Ramirez says the 3,400-member union will change its program to honor Chavez, who died last week at age 66. Chavez founded United Farm Workers of America to lead the struggle for better employment conditions among migrant workers.
OSU marine mammal specialist Bruce Mate announced that seal pupping is going on along the Oregon coast, and that beachgoers are likely to encounter baby seals that appear to be abandoned. Although your first reaction may be to run to the rescue of these wide-eyed cuties, Mate warns the best thing to do is leave the mammal on the beach. Because of their weak condition, newborn seals are often left on the mainland beach while the mother looks for food. Mate insists the pups will very likely grow into healthy adults if left alone. The mother seals often return at night to feed and care for the young seals. The people try to take them off the beach or push them back into the water. The seal pup will likely die. Once a seal pup is taken off the beach where it is left by the adult seal, it is unlikely the two will be reunited, Mate said. The pups are very difficult to raise in captivity and without expert care will suffer a slow, agonizing death. It is against the law to touch or move seals, and it is also dangerous. Seal bites can be painful and can cause infections in humans and pets. Mate also points out people should not let their dogs roam freely on the beach, as their presence might keep mother seals from returning to their pups. People who spot a seal pup believe that they in distress should call the Oregon State Police, the agency responsible for protecting them.
A Clinton administration official confirms that the administration will propose a scaled-back high-speed rail plan to be unveiled by Transportation Secretary Federico Pena and Congressional Railroad supporters today. The White House insider, speaking on condition of anonymity, says because of the deficit, the states will be asked to put up most of the construction money. During the election campaign, Clinton promised to build a high-speed rail system with savings from reduced defense spending.
An industry group survey done by the National Association of Manufacturers finds that small manufacturers are not hiring many new workers because of the fears of the government imposing increased taxes, implementing more government regulations, and President Clinton's new economic plans. The results of the poll find of the 1,900 businesses surveyed, 45% say they expect their payrolls to remain unchanged this year. About 20% expect job growth up to 5%, while the remaining polled expect growth of 10% or better.
Roseburg Forest Products is shutting down its third plywood mill indefinitely. Personnel manager Bob Wilson says falling plywood prices and continuing log shortages related to environmental battles led to the decision to close the plant on Friday. Howard Gosnell of the International Woodworkers of America says the plant's 200 workers haven't been told when they might return to work, but they expect the closure to be temporary.
The Oregon Senate has voted in favor of a measure to privatize the Oregon Public Broadcasting educational radio and television services. This would reduce state control over the public broadcasting service and transfer assets and licenses held by the state to a not-for-profit corporation known as Oregon Public Broadcasting. If OPB were to dissolve or to change its mission, the assets and licenses would be transferred to continue public broadcasting. Porter said privatizing OPB would give public broadcasting the flexibility to raise the money it needs to successfully compete in the market. Under the measure, the governor would appoint at least 20% of the members of the OPB board. Fiscal plans call for $5 million in state lottery funding to be assigned to OPB in the fiscal 1993-1995 year.
Albany City Council members are expected to repeal an outdated section of the city code that reads, "No female person shall frequent, loiter, or be employed in any tavern, cabaret, or nightclub for the purpose of soliciting a male person to purchase drinks." Albany Police Captain Wayne Hyde says the ordinance is antiquated. It was passed in the 1940s when many soldiers posted at Camp Adair, just west of the city, passed the time at Albany's bars. Hyde said that back then, women were hired to improve business for the owner by encouraging patrons to purchase drinks. Hyde also says that in his 26 years in Albany, the ordinance has never been enforced. City Attorney Jim Delaporte says the ordinances are obsolete and should be repealed.
The U.S. Labor Department says about 1,100 workers displaced by the shutdown of Trojan Nuclear Plant will be able to get retraining assistance under the Trade Act of 1974. An investigation found that both production and employment declined at Trojan in 1992 compared to the year before due to imports of electrical power. The Labor Department's regional office in Seattle said the employees of Portland General Electric Company who worked at Trojan in Rainier and lost their job after February 23rd are eligible for the benefits, as well as other employees who are affected by the increased imports. Oregon Division of Labor will administer the funds.
James Miskelly got more than he bargained for while clearing the brush from his Florida yard. He found what appears to be a Soviet-made missile. Miskelly thought it was a rusted tin can at first, but it kept growing and growing, and then he saw the point. A hotel executive, Miskelly says the 5-foot-long missile had the inscription "Captured 9 May 82 on its cone. A Navy ordnance team determined the missile was inactive, and a Navy spokesman says it will eventually be destroyed with other munitions. And when we return, new regulations governing Chinook salmon fishing off the southern coast of Oregon and northern coast of California. Ocean salmon seasons are set to begin Saturday, but the Commerce Department says an emergency rule will be issued by tomorrow. The U.S. Commerce Department announced today it will change Pacific salmon seasons to give more fish to the Native American tribes on the Klamath River. Commerce Secretary Ron Brown and Interior Secretary Bruce Babbitt have agreed to a management plan that changes key pieces of the seasons worked out by the Pacific Fishery Management Council. Brown says the changes show that he and Babbitt place top priority on conserving the Klamath River Chinook salmon. The action will eliminate a 6-day commercial trolling season starting Saturday on the California coast between Horse Mountain and Point Arena. The quota of Chinook that recreational fishermen take from May to June will be cut from 12,000 to 8,000 fish.
The Pacific whiting fly season opened up on April 15th after the Clinton administration approved a plan that many critics said favored the huge factory trawlers based in Seattle. The factory trawlers can collect catch from several small boats at once without the boats needing to come into port. Oregon Congressman Mike Kopetsky said the shoreside plants recovered only about 36 metric tons a day during the first 6 days of the season. He says the numbers are even worse than expected. The coastal fish processors say that the smaller boats have also been hampered by the bad weather and that plant managers don't expect to be operating until the end of May. The projected date for reaching the 112,000 metric ton limit is May 6, and trawlers have already reported hauling in more than 24,000 tons of the fish. If this continues, it will spell financial disaster for coastal towns.
State wildlife biologist Mike Black says a young female cougar wearing a track collar after her release 20 days ago was killed by a government hunter after the animal tried to eat a house cat and frightened some children in southern Oregon. Dave Sedon, founder of the Wildlife Images Wild Animal Rehabilitation Center in Grants Pass, says the cougar is the first to cause a problem out of 18 they have released into the wild over the past 16 years. The cougar and its litter mate were brought to the rehabilitation center as starving kittens 2 years ago after a hunter killed their mother. The goal of Wildlife Images Wild Animal Rehabilitation Center is to give the animals a second chance. The only other alternative is to kill them. Sedon adds that even cougars raised in the wild cause problems and many don't survive.
A suspected bank robber in Stratford, Connecticut, gave police a lot of help in catching him. Detectives say the robber left his name behind. As authorities tell it, Lee Womble wrote the words "the money" on a withdrawal slip and handed it to a teller. They say he had also written his name on it twice. One detective speculates the suspect was perhaps nervous or maybe just killing time. Since police arrested Womble within minutes of the robbery, it is likely he will now have plenty of time to kill. Coming up with our we have sports coming up next, so please stay tuned. Peter's going to tell us all about some good news and some bad news in sports coming up.
We have some bad news on the sports scene tonight. The New Orleans Saints team president has cancer. 65-year-old Jim Finks, who is a heavy smoker, has had respiratory problems for several weeks. He was hospitalized Monday. On another somber note, former North Carolina State basketball coach Jim Valvano died of cancer yesterday. Hundreds of people lined the sidewalk outside a Catholic church in Apex, North Carolina, to pay their last respects today. Funeral services are scheduled for tomorrow. On a happier note, the NBA playoffs on Friday night won't keep most valuable player Michael Jordan from opening his first restaurant with a party. He even said his first-round opponents, the Atlanta Hawks, would be welcome at the three-level sports bar and dining complex unless they beat us.
Four Salvation Army stores in Jacksonville, Florida have dubbed themselves grunge headquarters to take advantage of the current clothing rage in grunge. The stores can supply the discerning shopper with oversized worn flannel shirts, torn and faded jeans, a pair of clunky boots, and a bandana to knot over the hair. The Salvation Army's spokesman, Bill Keske, says sales are up over last year. They must be doing something right.
If you are a high school parent and are concerned about your child's safety, you'll be happy to hear that the state Senate has revised and passed a bill to make it a felony to carry a gun to school. The bill passed 16-13 yesterday and will now go to the House. Backers of the bill say it's needed to curb a dangerous trend of armed students. The only opponent to speak against the bill, Democrat Bill Dwyer, said it erodes constitutional rights and that the problem is one of parental lack of control.
We can all keep busy this weekend in spite of it being midterms. Mom's Weekend has a multitude of events from the movie Aladdin to hot air balloon rides to the Cinco de Mayo Festival Saturday evening. Gay Pride Week offers a dance at the MU Friday evening. The MU Concourse will have the exhibit Art Marks, and the MU will also host the world famous pottery sale. The ROTC will have the Navy Spring Awards Ceremony. Moms are admitted free to the Dixon Rec Center when accompanied by a student with student ID. Corvallis Transit will offer free trolley rides downtown and to the Timber Hill area until 5 p.m., so leave the car at home.
And lastly, a soccer game in Portugal wasn't just the shirts versus the skins, it was the skins versus the skins. Authorities say some visiting Scottish fans stripped off their kilts for a nude soccer match. 9 men were arrested, but the authorities say about 40 other nude soccer players got away. The 9 who were caught were fined in order to pack up their kilts and go home. That's the news in KBVR-TV tonight. Thanks for watching, and to Bob Richardson for fixing the teleprompter.
Good night.
Thank you. Bye.
Thanks, Bob.
You're welcome.
Thanks, Bob.
Hey, I hope they cut our audio.